Gollancx presents The Coming of the Dark, Immortal's Blood, Book 2, written and read by Chris Humphreys. Prelude. Two letters found in the vaults of the keep, castle of the warrior monks of Sagazar. The first, written by Macron, renegade of Corinthium, also known as Smoke, the prophet, to Anazat, leader of the warrior monks. The second, Anazat's reply. Hail, Lord. Though I would prefer to communicate as we usually do through smoke in the glass, I understand your need for something formal to take to the leaders of the four tribes of Sagazar, those horse lords, huntresses, seafarers, and your own monks, all formerly the most bitter of foes, who fought each other for hundreds of years before the revelation of the coming of the One. Praise her, praise him, united them. Still, I understand your cautions, and how difficult it must be to keep them united, how they require written facts rather than your mere reporting of a conversation. Thus have I written this on a separate page for you to dispose of, allowing you to share what follows. Honourable leaders of Sagazar, I have learnt that a young officer, Ferosh of the 9th Baalbek Riders, was brought to Corinthium as soon as he was killed and reborn, becoming the Empire's newest immortal. The powers there, Lucan, current leader of the Council of Lives, and his daughter, our most dangerous immortal enemy, Roxana, believe that this Ferosh has the abilities to lead the fight against me. So, in the Sanctum on the Hill, he was educated and corrupted, seduced by Roxana to bind him to her will. This despite the presence of a wife, Lara. My spies in the city report that, in despair, this young woman joined a suicide cult to try to force her own immortality. She failed, of course, and is dead. Ferosh has now been sent to deal with me and defeat the uprising of tribes I have arranged in the Empire's border province of Querdosia. He is as formidable as they think him, and has discovered the massing of our army beyond the mountains for the invasion which they did not know of until now. As I write this, and with a small troop, he pins my force of horse lords in the narrow tunnel between Sagazar and Querdosia, which was only 1 week from completion. Nevertheless, I am confident of breaking through within days to invade the southern part of Corinthium's empire as we planned. I will inform you through the glass when we achieve this. Please let me know how fare our other plans, and most especially, let me hear of the One. Praise her, praise him, praise the One. Anazat's reply. My Lord Macron, between the horse lord's skills and courage as warriors and your intelligence, I am confident that the southern invasion will happen as planned. You asked for information. The preparations in the north for the invasion of Midgarth are almost complete. As you know, over the years we have seriously weakened them by sending assassins over the mountains and killing a number of their immortals. We have two of their so-called gods in our thrall, Peki Asarko, a despicable yet powerful leader, lord of the Lake of Souls. He is still in Midgarth, undermining it, while I have their sole truly dangerous god, Luck of Ascorg, as a prisoner in the keep. He came seeking knowledge of us, and is certainly getting it. Both these Midgarthians are now slaves to the drug, Sirene. They journey with her when I allow them, and are sinking further into her embrace by the day. Soon they will be helpless to do anything other than obey our will. There are gods in Midgarth who are still formidable warriors. Their names are Hovard, Bjorn Swiftsword, Stromvar Dragonlord, and perhaps the cleverest of them all, Freya. Still, they do not know the size of the fleet we are assembling. The seafarers will launch the northern invasion as you launch yours. When the two moons meet in the sky on what we in Sagas Ar call the entwining. You ask also of the One. There we have true joy. The baby that is neither boy nor girl, but both, was indeed born, as prophesied to us in that far-off savage land of Ometepe. My spies there report this. The child's father, Intitepe, their ruler and god, and the only immortal male in that land because he has slain all the others, tried to murder the child because of a prophecy that said that just as he killed his father and his seven sons, so a son of his would one day kill him. He failed, for the mother, Atisha, was sent in error first to the city of women in the south of the country. Their revolt against his tyranny exploded. He is now dealing with a country in flames, and we will not be troubled by him again. Meanwhile, mother and child have been rescued by Korshak, Horse Lord, and by Jistran, Huntress. They are bringing the One to us by speedy vessel, reaching us before the invasions commence. So, the time is near, brother. When the two moons marry again in the sky, then will come the end of the dominion of the immortal and the beginning of the dominion of man. Every man and woman of the four tribes, together with devotees like yourself in every other land, will conquer the world, united under the banner of the child born to bring us into the light. Praise her, praise him, praise the One. From the end of Smoke in the Glass. The two men left at the gate had run out of arrows, and blades had driven them back. Six huge men were there, swinging vast double-handed swords. Ferosh threw one javelin, Gandalosh another. Both hit, then both ran forward. Four fought four at the cave entrance. Their enemy were hampered by the lack of space, their weapons suited to plain, not cave. Their steel drew sparks as they dragged points across the ceiling, trying for the high cut. So Ferosh stepped close and opened a man's stomach with a slice. Gandalosh stabbed another through the eye. The other soldiers killed as swiftly, and, for a moment, there were just the four of them there, heaving breaths. Until another man stepped through the entrance and made it five. He did not have a sword. He had a bow, and it was aimed at Ferosh's chest. There was an instant, just a small one, during which Ferosh thought he might do something, knew that the hesitation had probably cost him a life. This one, anyway. But Gandalosh did not hesitate, just stepped in front of Ferosh and took the arrow through his throat. "No!" cried Ferosh, catching his comrade's body as he fell, lowering him to the ground, aware of the two other soldiers as they stepped up and killed the bowman. Focused on the light as it left the young man's eyes. Then he heard the voice, recognized it immediately, which meant that he must have been struck too without even feeling it. He was dead, had to be, because the person who spoke was dead as well. "Rise, my love, rise and fight," she said. He looked up at her. She looked down at him, in the moment before she bent and snatched up Gandalosh's sword. For more of the enemy had burst into the cave, and she turned to take them on. Lara? Chapter 1. Resurrection. 4 weeks earlier, in the city of Corinthium, she woke with grave dirt in her mouth, and a dead man's arm across her chest. Crying out, Lara swallowed soil, choked, spat, took in more with a desperate breath, spat again. She was in complete darkness, with the stench of death, putrid and gamey, filling her nostrils as much as the earth did, and the weight of both pressing her from all sides. It told her she was not alone in the dark, that part of what pinned her was a body, that perhaps there was more than one. Though she'd never been a worshipper, she knew the stories of the afterlife, its joys and its horrors. Simbala ruled death, and she was known to be a capricious god, assigning some to happiness, some to eternal terror. It was clear that her failure to worship had condemned her to that second fate, to rot forever in this fetid darkness. She had sought immortality and found it only in a living grave. Lara wept. She screamed. But her tears and cries were swallowed in mud. She began to move all her limbs at once, arms and legs shifting the earth that encased her, fingers and toes clawing it aside. But any gap she made, where breath came easier for a moment, was soon filled, and earth closed round her again. The other bodies, two, she was sure of that now, came and went as if drowning in a sea beside her, seeking to pull her down with them ever deeper into the fathomless dark. Movement did nothing, changed nothing. Screams went unheard, prayers unanswered. Gradually she stilled, until her only movement was the sobbing and tears and snot that would not cease, and the breaths she somehow managed to take to stay alive. Alive. It was the thought word that stopped her. Why was eternal death her only option? What if there was something else? She realized that there already was, because the bodies beside her, her grave companions, were just that. Bodies, only moving when her movements made them. They did not claw, scream, weep as she did. She explored them with one hand. One was a man, one a woman. The man had an irregular face. It took her a while to remember the youth who'd stood beside her at Simbala's altar, with half his face eaten away by disease. This was him beside her. The woman, then, had to be the old one who'd sought immortality to stay with her younger lover. So there were differences in this pit, between the sentient and the senseless dead. And indifference, surely, surely, Lara thought, there must be choice. She forced a hand up to her mouth, began to slowly push the earth aside. It was crumbly, but she was able to form it when she spat on it, moulding a tiny cave for herself where breath came a little easier. With breath came not rest, the panic and terror were there, a collapse of earth away, but at least the ability to think for more than a few seconds at a time, to wonder, what if I am not dead? And whoever buried me thought that I was. She thought back. The last thing she remembered before waking here was the dagger slash that took her life. Back in that cave in Corinthium, where Corellia had brought her for the ritual of the suicide cult of Simbala, she had offered her throat to the woman behind the mask, who she had thought was her friend, but had been replaced by her enemy, by Roxana. The immortal. She did not understand how Roxana had transformed into Corellia in the ceremony. She did understand why she'd done it. For Roxana was her rival for the love of a man, her man, Feroz. And now she believes that she has succeeded, Lara thought. Fury seized her, cold as any grave. With fury came clarity. And then the realization that she did now have a choice. Accept this fate, this living death, or choose another. She was buried. She could not know how deep in the ground. She could only know that somewhere above her was a surface. And while she had even this little breath, she could climb up to that. The first task was to discover which way was up. The only thing that could still move other than her limbs was her mouth. She couldn't see, but she could feel. The pressure in her head made her guess that she was facing downwards, but since being killed no doubt made everything different, she had to be sure. So she used her lips to gather some of the clay-like mud before her, took it in, rolled it into a ball with her spit, forced both hands up to cup around her mouth, and pushed the ball out with her tongue. It landed on her left little finger. Tried it again, same result. As far as she could tell then, she was lying on her left side, facing down. So the surface was behind her, to her right. She could not know how far. She could only try to reach it. It took a while to turn herself over. When she was on her back, sure she was facing upwards, she began to dig beneath her with her heels and above with her hands, forcing the earth away. Slowly, so slowly she thought she barely moved, she got herself nearly turned and pointing up. Then, as slowly, she forced her arms above her and began to part the earth over her head. It took another age. Again and again she stopped, certain she had no strength left to continue. Did continue. She knew not how long. Time had no meaning in a grave. She kept going, and at some point the earth changed, loosened, became drier, less like clay, more crumbly. With a burst of energy she felt might be her last, she began to claw her way up, faster, her legs scissoring beneath her as if she were swimming, until there was a lighter type of darkness, until Lara burst from her grave. She lay on the surface, sobbing. It took her a while to notice anything other than that she was free. Gradually, her senses returned. She felt the cold of lying on the wet earth, made wetter and colder by the rain that fell. She was still clothed in what she'd worn for the ceremony, a light dress that gave little protection. Though it was deep night, she could see where she was by torches mounted in small guard turrets on a tall wall about 60 paces away, the land wall of Corinthium. So she was lying on ground outside the city. She did not know who had taken her there or why. Whether it was the cult itself, getting rid of its failures, or the authorities ridding the city of heretics and criminals. She was both now. She was also alive, and that was the greatest puzzle of all. She sat up, touched her throat. The last thing she remembered from the ceremony was the dagger being slashed down by Roxana, the immortal who had somehow taken the place of Lara's friend, Corellia. She remembered the eyes glittering in triumph beneath the mask, just before the agony of steel opening her throat and the death that followed it. Yet she had not died. And the skin that she touched now was not a gaping wound, but one that was healing. Lara's eyes shot wide open. She brought both hands up to her mouth and gasped. Everything else, the cold rain, the taste of earth in her mouth, her ceaseless shuddering, all disappeared, shoved aside by the power of a new truth. She was immortal. The suicide cult that had produced only 3 immortals since the founding of the city had now produced a 4th. Her. It was wonderful. It was terrible. Her life was over. And she would live forever. When her racking sobs finally ceased, she became aware that, immortal or not, she was cold, starving, exhausted. She needed shelter, water, food. There were lighted windows facing the city walls. People who could not squeeze their way into Corinthium but wanted to live close to it had set up clusters of shacks. Forcing herself to her feet, Lara staggered towards the mortals. 4 days later.
Tomko?
Lara turned to the man who'd called.
Sir?
The head groom, Petros, threw her a curry comb.
Give Sarana a good going over.
He leaned and spat into a pile of straw.
It's the fucking queen who's riding her, so you better make her fucking beautiful or you'll fucking catch it.
Sir?
Lara said again.
and went to the stall where the Torpan mare waited. Gentling her with clicks in the throat, she slipped a bridle over her head and led her out into the yard and over into a patch of sunlight. The rains had finally ceased, and a winter sun returned. Sheltered by its walls from the chill easterly winds, the sunny side of the yard was almost hot. Though Lara had found that, having experienced the coldness of a grave, nothing kept her warm for long. Exercise helped, and she went hard at Serana's long and luxuriant coat. The mare loved it, while Lara had always loved horses and the care of them. For the first few moments of the combing, she could lose herself in the scent and the feel. Imagine herself back in Baalbek, preparing her own mare, Cypher, for a morning ride. Think of herself as she'd been, when she'd been both mortal and happy, when she'd had only one purpose, to be with and to please her man. Before her purpose had become to kill the woman who had stolen that man and had tried to kill her, no, had succeeded in killing her, the mortal her. The thoughts made her cease combing, and Serana's eyelashes unfolded, her look plainly saying, "Don't stop." She began again, though less vigorously than before. She was distracted first by her thoughts, and then by the open window above her. For through it she now heard voices, one of which was his. Ferosh. She'd first heard it the day before, soon after she'd bluffed her way into the stables of the sanctum, by the luck of claiming and calming a runaway horse, which had escaped from the yard and dashed past her shortly after she'd taken up position on the street outside its gates. She'd recognized Fortune's touch and seized it, throwing herself across the horse bareback when it slowed near a broken wagon, calming it with gentle touches of the bridle, her thigh, her soft words. Petros, the head groom, had been impressed with the lad, Tomko, for Lara had borrowed boys' clothing from the first people who'd sheltered her outside Corinthium's walls and decided it was safer to remain as one. When she told him she was an orphan looking for a job and had nowhere to live, he'd taken pity on her, taken her on and in. For all his gruffness and foul language, he was a kind man who'd lost his own young son to the sea 3 years before. When she'd first heard Ferosh in that room above, she'd yearned to run straight into his arms. For he was weeping, something she'd not witnessed in her tough soldier in their 5 years together. Laughter, always. Tears, never. And she knew, because she could hear her name cried out, that he wept for her death, knew she could take that misery away by going to him and saying, "I live, love, more. I live, like you, forever." But as she'd tried to figure out a way from the stables up into that room, into his arms, she'd heard her voice, the fucking queen's, as Petros had just called her, heard her comforting, sensed her taking Ferosh into her arms, holding him, consoling him, loving him. The immortal who'd killed her, the immortal who she'd vowed to kill. So she'd stopped herself. For one, she knew that she was not a killer, did not know the way of it. Not yet. While she had directly experienced that Roxana was gifted in those skills. But even more limiting than that was her ignorance of immortality. How could she kill someone who could not die? Who would be born again, even as she herself had been born again, birthed from a grave. Who had also instantly taken the place of her friend in the suicide ceremony by some act of dark magic. Roxana was more than an immortal. She was a witch. So Lara had taken a breath, returned to her duties, swallowed her yearning. For now, she needed to free herself from ignorance before she acted. How? She did not know, but she assumed that since Simbala had chosen her, for Lara now believed in the gods as she never truly had before, that the goddess would continue to place opportunities before her, just as she had with the runaway horse. Besides,
And this was also a true and real thing. Feroche had betrayed her with this fucking queen. She knew. She could sense it. She could smell his betrayal through the window, its scent in her nostrils stronger than the mares that she combed. It was no longer a question of taking him back. It was not simply about revenge. He must earn his right to be with her with more than his tears, prove that it was her that he chose above any other. Vengeance needed to wait for that. Wait for opportunity and a further blessing of the goddess. Which came even on the thought, on the opening of the door from the palace into the yard. Came on a voice she recognized, the first voice she and Feroche had heard in the city when they'd stepped onto the dock from the ship that had brought them from Baalbek 6 weeks before.
"Petros! Petros!"
the voice of a man, high-pitched.
"They have closed the heaven road for winds, and I must be in Sevropol in 2 hours."
"A palanquin, Lord Straeoni?"
inquired Petros, emerging from the stables, rubbing his hands on a cloth.
"Of course, immediately, and your 12 strongest bearers. None of those limping dullards you fobbed me off with last week."
Lara looked at the man, remembered him, though she and Feroche had not been sure that he was him at all. Such was the amount of makeup he'd worn, his high voice, and the multicoloured fabrics that had swathed his vast body. Later, Feroche had told her, in their room above the tavern, that Straeoni was indeed a man, a famous actor, poet and singer, and something more than that, the innovator of the great spectacles, producer of the huge celebrations or pageants staged throughout the year, but especially at last week's Feast of Simbala. Then Feroche had told her something else, that Straeoni was also one of the immortal elite. So she realized, as she continued making the mare's coat glossy and smooth while the palanquin was readied, that Straeoni would have all the knowledge she required. All she had to do was find a way to make him tell her everything. When his vehicle was ready, Straeoni slipped into its cushioned, silk-walled interior, and 12 hefty men, 3 on each corner pole, bent and lifted. As it was carried from the yard, Lara led Sirana back to her stall. Petros would want her to ready the mare for riding, but he would just have to do that himself. Quietly, Lara slipped through the gates. It was easy enough to hang back and follow the palanquin. Though the streets were quiet on Agueroche, the highest hill of the city, because only immortals and those who tended them lived upon it, each hill below got ever more crowded. The main street that was the spine of the city, the Stradun, was 3 palanquins wide and well paved. She'd heard that ancient regulations demanded that it be kept clear for the rapid movement of the elites through Corinthium. But if those laws had ever been observed, it was a long time past. As more and more people came to live in the city, all space was colonized. Market stalls were set up before almost every shop front, and people milled before them, while carts and wagons brought goods to service them. All traffic slowed and often blocked the way. The red banner at the crown of the vehicle's silk roof was meant to guarantee swift passage, but people found ways of ignoring it until they were forced aside by bellows from the palanquin's leader at the head of the left pole, or by blows from the baton he carried. It was why, 100 years before, the elites had created the Heaven Road. They could cruise above the people and mock them from on high. Lara followed close, concealment unnecessary. She was just another street kid, an orphan of the city, of which there were many. Though if they knew who she was, she'd heard her name called out many times at crossroads in the 3 days since her resurrection. The suicide cults were ruthlessly persecuted, and the names of any of those who'd killed themselves proclaimed and reviled. Leaders of the group had been executed, and their bodies hung by their heels, dripping blood on government office walls. She'd wondered if her friend, Corellia the Whore, was one of them. Except it wasn't Corellia who had slit her throat. It was Roxana. This Lara knew. It was something she would never forget. The eyes glittering triumphant beneath the mask as the dagger slashed down. For now, that memory was only horror. To make it something else, she needed answers. Answers that could be provided by the man in the palanquin. It took almost 2 hours to reach their destination, the fourth hill of Corinthium, and so about the midpoint between Aguerosh and the harbour. Because of its centrality, Sevropol had become known for entertainment, and people would come from all over the city to partake in its delights, which ranged from the classical plays that were performed in the elegant theatres that lined this part of the Stradun, no stalls before their gilded entranceways, to less refined activities in the alleys that wound off on every side. In those, every appetite was catered for. Taverns, ox roast halls, cockpits and dog pits for the fighting of those creatures and the wagering upon them. Bawdy ballads were sung, and clothes stripped slowly off in houses beside brothels. Everywhere wine and ale flowed, with men and women shouting their competing wares, luring fresh customers. She and Ferosh had walked up there once in their first week in the city and clung to each other, wide-eyed provincial folk stunned by the sensual assault of the place. But that was then, and this is now, thought Lara, stepping into a shuttered shop's doorway as the palanquin halted before one of those marble-columned theatre fronts and was finally set down. Now she was not intimidated at all by the noise and the hustle. Dying will do that to you, she thought, chewing her lower lip. She couldn't hear what Strayoni said to the head poleman. Wait, she assumed, as the bearers all bowed, then moved away in twos and threes in search of refreshment. Strayoni went off alone, not, she was surprised to see, into the plush theatre. Instead, he pulled his scarf in front of his face, a hood over his head, and entered one of the alleys. She hurried to catch up, saw him as he turned the first corner ahead. She hadn't noticed before, in her one swift glance in the stable yard, but the great innovator was not dressed in the peacock finery of their very first encounter. When she and Ferosh had met him on the docks, they'd had that doubt as to his gender. There was no question he was a man here, shod in sturdy boots and with a rough woven cloak covering basic breeches and jacket. When she'd caught up, was just 5 paces behind him, he turned. Before she stepped into a doorway, she saw that he also sported none of the face paint he'd worn then. Just as well for him, she thought, as she noted the alley's inhabitants. The deeper into Sevropol they got, the narrower the way became. The darker, too, with house roofs almost conjoined above, blocking out the sky. Hard-faced men watched her a little longer as she passed, gauging. Cries came from open doorways. Some were faked pleasure, some fear, some drunken laughter. She avoided the eyes of the men that stared at her, clutched the dagger at her waist a little harder, prayed that she would not be forced to use it, since she did not truly know how. Strayoni halted before a plain brown door and looked each way up the alley before knocking. What are you about? She wondered, as she shifted to the other side of the alley so she could see both man and door. A hatch opened in it. She glimpsed a mouth, shaping words. Strayoni murmured a reply. The door opened, and he slipped inside. Lara crossed the alley, pressed the door. It was locked. She didn't knock. Strayoni must have spoken some kind of password that she couldn't know. But she also couldn't stay where she was and wait for him. She'd noticed one man in a doorway further down, with the sallow complexion of a drinker and hunger in eyes that he kept on her. As he moved towards her, she slipped into another alley to her right, even darker than the one she'd left. Its wall was part of the same house that Strayoni had gone into, and it ran down to yet another alley that had to be the house's rear. She took it, even as she heard footsteps behind her, praying that it wasn't a dead end, that she wouldn't be trapped. It was, but she wasn't. There was a heap of broken furniture and wooden crates against the wall beneath a window ledge. Without even considering it, she scrambled up the pile, stretched, leaped. Her fingers gripped the ledge as the pile gave way, but she held on, pulled herself up and through the window, which, miraculously, was open. She saw that she was in a bedroom, unoccupied, but lamplit and reeking of cheap scent. As she lowered herself to the floor, she heard a slurred curse through the open window. She waited. In the alley, the man muttered, moved away. Ahead, the door of the bedroom was ajar, and through it she heard voices. One was high-pitched. She recognized it. So, creeping forward, she put her hand to the door frame and listened.
"All is ready?"
Straeoni asked. The voice that answered was deeper, gentle, a man, well-spoken. "All, Lord Straeoni."
"And has he..." There was a hesitation. "Has he said anything to you about what must be done now?"
"Nothing, Lord. Why would he speak to me? It's you he wants." This was not said gently. Straeoni coughed.
"Very well," he said more firmly. "Leave me. Wait elsewhere. I will begin."
"Lord." Someone came out of the room on the floor below. Lara slipped back into the shadows behind the door, looking about for a place to hide in case this was the man's destination. But she heard him go the other way. When another door closed somewhere below, she stepped out and softly descended the stairs to the lower landing. There were two doors there, one fully open and giving onto another scented bedroom, also empty and draped like the one above in gaudy silks with a basin and jug on a stand. Though she had never been in one, she had a sense that she was standing in a brothel. The second door was old, with frayed wood and peeling paint. The man who'd left had pulled it closed, but, warped as it was, it had not fully shut. She bent to listen at the gap, heard Straeoni sigh deeply. Something came into her nostrils, an acrid smoke that made her gag. Though her every instinct made her want to turn away, she knew she could not. Answers lay within the room. Slowly, she pushed the door open enough to thrust her head in. Straeoni was sitting in one corner, facing into it and partly away from her. Before him, on a stand that in the other room would have held a jug and basin, Lara could see a glass globe the size of a small watermelon. Smoke swirled within it. Smoke which, even as she watched, cleared, and a man's head appeared. A man with a beard, long hair, deep-set eyes. She raised her hand to her mouth to contain her gasp. What witchcraft was this? As the man within the smoke spoke.
"Straeoni," he said.
"Macron?"
"All is well?"
"All is not well."
Straeoni's voice rose higher in complaint.
"I do not like this place you force me to come to. It is," he shuddered, "filthy."
"I told you before, a globe must never be used in the sanctum. Lucan has too many eyes and ears there. He must never know we can talk like this."
"But you also promised that if I came here today, there would be more of this."
Straeoni picked up a glass vial, turned it upside down.
"But this is the last of it."
"I sent more. But my first vessel was attacked by the pirates of Omersh and had to turn back to Querdosia."
Full, sensual lips shaped a smile.
"I cannot control pirates, Straeoni."
"Nevertheless..."
"More is on the way. I have sent it in 3 separate ships. Perhaps all will arrive at once and you will have... plenty."
As Straeoni went to complain again, the man barked, "Enough!" And then continued,
"Now, tell me of the sanctum."
Lara shifted slightly, so she could see more of Straeoni's face as well as the other man's. There was something hypnotic about that other. He lulled her. She accepted what was plainly dark magic, a man speaking within a globe of smoke. She also knew that she would never want to look into that man's eyes for long.
"Someone has come.
A new-birthed immortal. Lucan and his daughter are very excited by him. They say he is special. To me, he seems just another rough soldier.
The cavalryman of Balbec, I have heard of him. Why are they so excited?
They think he is the one foretold.
Foretold to do what?
Straeoni cleared his throat.
To deal with you, Macron.
Deal with me?
The man laughed.
He would have to be very special indeed.
He nodded.
What else?
He came with a wife.
Lara leaned closer as Straeoni continued.
But she joined a suicide cult.
Macron frowned.
That seems strange. Besides, I thought they were long suppressed.
They were, but they spring up. The ceremony was discovered, all participants killed.
Wait.
The man in the globe stared above Straeoni, raised a hand, rubbed either side of his beard.
Roxana did this?
What do you mean?
There are no coincidences. Roxana would have wished to get rid of this wife. She only knows one way of controlling a man, seducing him, bewitching him. A rival would prevent that.
As you would know, Lord.
The sunken gaze returned to Straeoni. No trace of a smile now.
As I would know.
He nodded, then continued.
So this girl is out of the way. What next?
They are letting the soldier mourn for a week, and then he and Roxana are sailing for Querdosia.
To deal with me.
It wasn't a question, and Straeoni simply nodded.
I need you to delay them. My work here is not yet complete. I have one tribe yet to bring to our side. It will take a little time more. How would you advise I delay them? They are far more powerful than I.
Oh, come, Straeoni.
Macron laughed.
You may be soft and foolish as yourself, but you have the ability to possess, as we all do.
You'll simply have to possess someone stronger to do your bidding.
I can do that, yes.
Straeoni shook his head.
But someone as strong as Lucan, as Roxana?
No. But you will have surprise on your side. They will not be expecting it from you.
He looked suddenly to the side. He nodded, turned back, and his eyes narrowed.
Do it. Delay them. One of my ships will arrive within 2 weeks with Sirene. The next time we meet, I expect a report of your triumphs.
Lord, wait, I...
But Macron didn't wait. Smoke swirled in the globe, and the face was gone. Straeoni slumped back. He lifted the glass vial he still held, tipped it again. Nothing came from it. He sniffed at it, sighed, corked it, and threw it into the satchel at his waist. Lara didn't understand much of what had passed between the two men. She did not understand how it had passed. But then, everything she'd understood of the world had changed from the moment she'd woken up in her grave. She had been awed by the city, by its inhabitants, been hesitant in her dealings with them in a way she never would have been back home in Balbec. No more. She needed to understand now, right now. The man rising from his chair would help her do that.
Straeoni,
she said. He yelped, staggered back, banging into the stand, which tipped. With another cry, he grabbed the globe just before it fell.
You fool, he shouted. Look what you nearly made me do.
He replaced the globe on the stand, turned back.
I told Severosh that I would call when I was done. Why did he send you?
No one sent me. I came by myself.
What are you talking about, boy?
Straeoni leaned closer, his expression puzzled.
Do I know you?
We've met.
Met? Met where?
He peered at Lara.
No, I don't know you.
He frowned.
But did you... How long were you standing there?
Long enough.
You mean you saw?
Frown turned to fury.
You interfering little fool! You are going to have to answer some questions now.
He stepped forward, his big hands reaching. Lara stepped back.
"I'll answer yours," she said, drawing her dagger, "if you answer mine."
Straeoni looked down, focusing on the blade. Then he looked up.
"Oh, young man, you don't know what you have done. And Macron did say I would need to start using the gift again to do his bidding. May as well start with you."
"What gift?" she said. He took a step backwards, laughed.
"Come here, you," he said, opening his arms wide.
Straeoni did not move, remained on the other side of the room. And yet Lara felt as if he'd rushed across and crashed into her. She felt as if his whole bulk had hit her, and she reeled back into the wall as if struck. But there was something else, too, in his touch of her. He had touched the whole of her, inside and out, tried to penetrate her, occupy her, possess her. It was what the man in the smoke had said, one of the many things she had not understood. She understood it now, all of it. The one touch had told her, not in her mind, far deeper than that, in her whole being. Now she knew why Corellia had become Roxana, or rather, how. How Roxana had taken the old whore over to do her bidding. Possession. It was an ability, like the healing of all wounds, birth after death. Yet not only did she understand it, she understood in that same ferocious moment of total contact that she could do it, use it, become anyone she chose, for a time. She would not know for how long until she tried. Something in that first touch told her it could not last long. But while it lasted, it would be extraordinary. All this she understood in seconds, those few while she looked across the room at Straeoni. He had not moved, was still across the room, though the fury on his face had changed to shock.
"But you're immortal too. You have to be, or I'd be in you now."
She raised her hands, the one with the dagger, the one without, looked at them in wonder.
"I really am. Wait, I do know you," he gasped. "You are the suicide."
He broke off.
"It's impossible, and yet..."
He shook his head, and his voice deepened.
"You'll come with me. You'll come with me to the sanctum right now."
It wasn't that he shouted this last that made her know she wouldn't. She knew that already. She might have learned, in an instant, the secret power, the true power of immortality. But the woman who'd killed her was in the sanctum. And Roxana had 300 years' experience of this wonder. Lara was not ready to face her, not yet.
"No," she said. "You will come," he began screaming. "Severosh! Severosh! Quickly! Bring rope!"
Lara turned to flee. Straeoni, for a big man, moved fast across the room.
"No, you don't," he cried, seizing her shoulder. "You'll stay here."
Lara whipped back.
"What?"
Straeoni said, his eyes widening. Lara stepped away. Both looked down at the dagger sticking from his chest.
"Fool,"
he moaned as he sank to the floor. There were raised voices below, boots on the stairs. Lara ran out and up, back into the bedroom she'd first entered, was out the window, lowering herself from its ledge, even as men came shouting into the room. She dropped, ran down the alleys and then into the crowds on the Stradun. If any pursued her, they would not find her now. She walked with no destination. She was not sure what to do next. A decision would arrive when it must, she felt. For now, she was content to sit with what she'd discovered, the astonishing things that she had learned. The first, that she could kill if she needed to. Even if Straeoni would be reborn soon enough, she had not considered that when she put her knife into his heart. The second was this astounding ability, as astounding as immortality itself. That she would also need to sit with for a while. Then as with her destination, she would decide what she would do. 4 weeks later, in the caves of Querdosia. "Rise, my love! Rise and fight!" Feroz looked up at her. She looked down at him, in the moment before she bent and snatched up dead Gandalosh's sword. For more enemies had burst into the cave, and she turned to take them on.
"Lara?"
But there was no time to do anything other than gasp her name, not with five more men there, bent on their deaths. He rose just as Lara lunged, driving her sword straight at the leading man's belly. He parried it, yelping, swinging his own sword down hard, staggering back, his body penning the others for a moment in the narrow tunnel entrance. A moment Feroz seized, grabbing a dropped shield by its center strap, slamming it into the staggering man's chest, knocking him further backwards into the men who followed him. They were a tangle of limbs and blades. He, Lara, and the other two soldiers, a rising whirl of steel. It took only moments, and then there was just them, with the dying and the dead adding to the flesh pile before the inner cave's entrance. Then others were with them. 10 of his soldiers rushing forward, these with javelins and shields, snapping into a wall of leather and metal. No enemy now came, and, seeing the pause, Feroz seized Lara's arm and pulled her back towards the cave mouth, then out. The clouds had cleared, the rains had gone, and in the two moon's light, waxing horned cipher, waning blue revlash, he could at last see her clearly. Yet seeing did not help him believe. He reached a hand, laid fingers on her cheek, as if touch could make her real.
"How? How?"
"You can guess the how.
So you,
he shook his head.
"You did not die."
"I did, as you did. Then I was reborn, as you were."
"Oh, my love."
He grabbed her then, pulled her tight into his chest. "I thought I'd lost you. I mourned."
"I know."
She pulled away, so she could see his eyes. "I watched you in the temples, crying out my name, before you boarded the ship."
"You watched me? You were there? Then why did you not—"
Confusion furrowed his brow.
"You saw my pain. I thought you were gone forever. Worse, that I had caused you to die."
His voice rose.
"Why did you not come to me then?"
"Why? You know why." She stepped from the shelter of his arms.
"Because of who was with you?"
"Because of her."
"Roxana," he swallowed. "She gave me sympathy."
"Oh, is that what she gave you?"
"Lara, I—"
He raised a hand to her in supplication, then let it fall.
"I thought you were dead." "Not when you first fucked her, you didn't."
He winced at the hard edge of her voice.
"It's true, I was bewitched."
"Of course. Poor boy, you couldn't help yourself. It wasn't your fault." Savagery in her tone made him step away. "You weren't there. You can't know," he said, lowering his eyes.
"I wasn't there," she sought his eyes, "and neither was she."
His gaze jerked up at her.
"What do you mean?"
"After you did whatever you did, she came to the suicide ceremony. She took over the priestess." She ran her tongue over her lips.
"It was Roxana who killed me."
He stepped away.
"No, I do not believe it. How would she do that?"
"You know how. It comes with immortality. The bonus." Lara spat the word. "Like I just did with Gandalosh."
"Gandalosh?"
Feroz looked back into the cave.
"You possessed him. Used him. As if you haven't done it already."
His gaze sharpened.
"I have not. Why would I? It is barbaric."
"You haven't?
Truly?"
She shook her head.
"But Feroz, it is not barbaric. Well, it is. But it is also wonderful."
Feroz started to reply, and then shouts distracted him, both from the caves, where the clash of steel on steel could again be heard, and on the plain ahead, where cavalrymen were galloping hard towards them. It was the 20 who'd led the Asani away, while Ferosh and his men had chased the Prophet Smoke into the mountain. He'd lost a few in there. Gandalosh was one. But with the 15 who'd survived, he had 35 men now. All Vattenvolden, too, hardened fighters from the northern forests of the Empire. Enough to hold the narrow entrance behind him for a time. Long enough, he hoped, for Roxana to return from Tarfona, bringing its garrison to help him prevent the invasion he'd seen was coming. The troop sergeant was at the head of the column that reined in. "Straight in," Ferosh called, pointing at the cave. "Javelins and shields." The men obeyed, dismounted, rushed in. It would be tight for that many men in the cave. None of the enemy would be able to force their way past. For now. He turned back to Lara, hesitated. What could he say to her? What to ask? How to explain? "Lara," he began. "This is not the time, Ferosh. There are too many things between us now. I will rest for a while, and then I will join you in the fight." "As," he looked at the three men the troop had left to tether the horses, "you will not." She followed his gaze. "I will not. Gandalosh was an exception to stay close to you. I only possess enemies unless my need is very great, as it was to get on a boat to follow you to this land. And you would know, if you were not so afraid, that possession is hard on the body. It cannot be done time after time." Afraid? It was not a word his old Lara would have used of him. And it was another thing he could not deal with now. "Rest. I would prefer it if you did not fight. There is no need. In there we have enough." He turned to go, and she took his arm, delaying him. "Know this, Ferosh. When she returns, I will be someone else for a time. I do not want her to know me, not yet. I still do not know what I am going to do, and you must swear to me that you will not tell her." Another realm of questions opened before him. None could be asked now. "I swear it, and now I must go. We will talk later." He turned and ran into the cave. Lara staggered and placed her hand against the rock face. It did cost one, possession, the coming and the going of it. But her weakness was more than that. Suddenly being with him again, the man who'd been her everything for so long. Being with him, and being so furious with him. She was different in every possible way, and that included her love for him. It was there, but it was different too. In what lay ahead, she would have to discover just how different. There was a sudden, loud increase of noise, funneling out from the cave as if it were a mouth. Men with swords, she thought, pulling her own weapon from its scabbard, noting the blood staining its shiny plains. I can be one of those.
Chapter 2. The Vision. It was a week before Luck was summoned again. He thought that strange, that the leader of the monks, Anazat was his name, Luck had discovered, had not wanted to interrogate him further and immediately. Until he realized that what the monk had told him when he first arrived was true. He was not there as a prisoner, but as an honored guest. They'd declared a truce, and neither would break it until both did. He tested it, of course he did. First, he slept for a day and a night. On the second morning, he'd woken ravenous. Fresh food, cured meats, cheese, bread, fruits, most of which were new to him, awaited on a table, along with a jug of juice and another filled with clear mountain water. Hot water had been poured into a trough with walls that came to his mid-thigh, so he stripped, used cloths and the scented contents of a small glass bottle to wash and rinse himself, finally ridding himself of a stench that was near as bad as that of the hibernating bear he'd woken and possessed on the other side of the mountain. He did not wish to put his old clothes back on for the same reason, then saw that he did not need to, for someone had hung a robe on the back of the door. It was cut like the one he'd seen Anazat and his acolytes wear, of soft wool, though when he slipped it on, he discovered it was lined in linen. It was the most comfortable thing he'd ever worn. It fitted him perfectly, as did the deerskin, fleece-lined shoes he also found. The right one had an extra sole, because his right leg was shorter than the left. It was clear that while he slept, he had been carefully studied. "I will study in my turn and test the bounds of this liberty," he thought. "Just because a cage does not have bars, does not mean it is not a cage." Yet, seek as he might, he could not find any bars. He explored the fortress, or the keep, as its residents called it, wandered from the huge kitchens in the depths to the eyries in the tops of the guard towers. There were people everywhere. Monks in cowls, cooks and servants, armed sentries. All were similar, most of what would have been mid-height in Midgarth. All had dark hair, the little of it that he could see, for all had their heads shaved, save for a small circle of black about the crown. None of them challenged him, nor asked his purpose there, answered any questions he asked, if they could, for most could not speak his language. Though even these conveyed to him the same simple answer from servant to soldier, each had been called to worship and to serve. The question of what or whom exactly he would save for Anazat. Still, that summons did not come. On his second day of exploration, one monk revealed that the head monk was not even there, had gone out into the world to deal with matters of high import. So Luck, wondering what orders had been left, tested the cage still further, by walking through the keep's main gate, descending a little way down the switch-backed road that led to the valley far below. Got 300 paces to realize that no one followed him, or sought to bring him back. He was free, which irked him once he'd accepted it, for Anazat knew he wasn't going anywhere. Anazat had set a hook with exactly the bait this fish would eagerly seize, the promise of knowledge. Had rightly guessed that Luck had always craved that. So when he returned to the castle, he arranged for an elderly monk, Perakach, to start to teach him this writing that Anazat had showed him when he'd first arrived. Symbols on a page that others could read and interpret? He'd recognize the power in it immediately. And speaking the written words aloud, gently corrected in pronunciation by his tutor, he began on that first day, and the ones that followed, to learn to speak the language of the place too. The language's name was Tolandpa Sen, which meant the one word. He'd learned there were other peoples in this world, this vast world. Four tribes, Perakach told him. Tolandpa Sen was the common tongue they used to speak to each other. In only one thing was he restricted. This he discovered on the fourth morning when, after long hours spent deciphering written words and saying them in Perakach's cell, he decided to visit the stables again. He had always liked horses and was amazed by the contrast between the small, shaggy-coated ones he knew in Midgarth and the huge, sleek beasts most rode in Sagas Ah. He indicated to a groom that he would like to take one for a ride. Again, he was not denied. So he went back to his cell to put on his old breeches and doublet, clothes which were better suited for a ride than a robe. They'd been taken the day before, cleaned, patched, and returned, and now hung from hooks above something new. All the belongings he'd brought from Midgarth. Someone had found his boat sled in the woods. The vessel itself was not there, but everything else was. His cooking pot, the knife Hovard had given him, his short axe, his one change of clothes, even his slingshot with its bag of smoothed killing stones. But what held his gaze was the seeing globe that he'd taken from the assassin back in Midgarth. Smoke swirled within it. Only one thing was missing, as he discovered while conducting an ever more frantic search, the vial of the liquid drug that he would pour upon the glass to see, to travel. He felt instant hunger. Truly, it had never fully gone away since that first time, a nag always at the edge of his mind. He tried to ignore it, resist its lure. Now, seeing the globe without the means to use it, he wanted to, suddenly, immediately. So he would. He leaned into the corridor. Anyone there? Though he never had any sense of being followed, someone somehow was always within earshot. Sir, came the reply, and a moment later a young man appeared, a cleaning cloth in hand. All who'd been assigned to his care did speak some of his language. It was one of the duties for those who lived at the keep, he'd discovered, to learn the tongues of other lands. I want something, Luck said. Anything, sir. Bring me a vial of sirene. The young man's eyebrows, plucked to the thinnest of lines to match the circlet of hair about his crown, shot high. Is not possible. But you just said anything. You wait, please. The young man bobbed a bow, then ran back along the corridor and disappeared down the stairs. Luck went back into his cell, lay down for a moment, couldn't stay prone, rose, went to the window. Both above and below him, swallows dived, swooping into the eaves, small sticks in their beaks. I'd like to soar again, Luck thought, but in a different way. Sir? It was a deeper, lower voice that turned him to the cell's entrance. A big man stood there, one he'd never seen before. Older, the hair that circled his crown entirely grey. You need something. This man spoke Luck's language almost as well as Anazat, with a light accent. Luck gestured to the globe he'd placed on the small table. Yes, bring me sirene, please. That is not possible. I thought anything was possible. For me. Luck took a step forward, aware that his voice had risen slightly in pitch. He felt anxious, feared denial. Centered his voice before he spoke again. Did Anazat not tell you to give me everything I desire? I desire this. I like to help, the man said, coming further in, hands raised in a gesture of calm. In this I cannot. Will not. Cannot, the man repeated. Sirene is locked away. Only Anazat has key. He is not here. You're lying! Luck could not help his shout. Anazat wants me to do this! Sir, please. The monk stepped nearer. Sirene is not to be approached casually, especially by someone who is inexperienced with her. She is not controllable. She will... He broke off. You need a guide. I don't want a guide. He looked up into the man's eyes, his voice dropping to a growl. And I wish to lose control. Trust me. The man laid his hand on Luck's arm. You do not. Luck was about to throw the man's arm off, to shout more, demand. But this close to him, he noticed something he hadn't before. His eyes, if not fully black, were shaded in it, muddying the whites there. This man had experienced sirene, too. And Luck saw things in his eyes that he knew were a mirror for his own. Craving, yes, but sadness, too. Deep, unquenchable sadness. He stepped back. What is your name? He asked more quietly. The man bowed. Toparak. You know of what you speak, don't you? I know. There was an infinity of sadness in the pause between words. It calmed Luck suddenly. The craving did not leave him entirely, but it loosed its tight hold on him. For he recognized, from his brief experiences with her so far, that sadness would be part of any encounter he had with Sirene. The man noted the calming, and his tension eased too. Anazat returns tomorrow. Then I think you will voyage again. Again, there were other things in the pause. Envy, perhaps. Sadness. Luck nodded. Very well. The man straightened, stepped back. Is there anything else I can do for you, sir? Yes. You can tell me if you ride. Ride? For the first time, the man smiled, and some of his pain left him. I was born on a horse. I come from the sea of grass, where the horse is life. But I haven't ridden in a long time. Neither have I, said Luck. Join me, and show me some of the world beyond these walls. I will. Toporak was a good guide in everything. The tack required to control the large horses of Sagas-Ah was quite different from the simple harness that Luck used in Midgarth, and he altered it further to suit his weaknesses at leg and shoulder. The horse was different, too, and though he mounted a grey gelding, while Toporak took a black stallion, Luck's horse was still far livelier than anything he'd ridden back home. Yet he had done more than simply ride, of course. He had possessed horses a score of times over the centuries, knew them in a way no mortal rider, however gifted, ever could. And though there were differences of temperament, a horse's desires, unlike a man's, were usually fairly clear. Do what must be done before getting back to a warm stable and hay. Toporak, who indeed looked like someone who'd ridden before he walked, having given a few simple tips, was impressed. You can sit a horse, sir, he said, running his tongue over his lips. But can you race one? Challenge given, accepted. Neither man had spurs, neither needed them. A tap of heels, an easing of reins, a cry of yah! And the two were off, side by side, down a forest trail that ran from a side gate of the keep. There were deadfall trunks to jump, avenues of melting snow to skid along. They left the forest, riding hard along a track that took them ever higher up the mountain. They reined in at last on a shelf of stone that jutted out over the valley, now far, far below them. It was an even better view of the world than back at the fortress. The spring sun was upon the land. In the distance to his left, he could see men in the bell tower, the rest of the keep hidden by folds of land. In the clear air, he could pick out clefts and fissures in the far distant range of mountains opposite the one on which they sat their horses, as well as other features of the valley below. A wide river flowed through it between vast fields, all bordered in stone walls. Ploughmen moved oxen across some, while large herds of cattle stood on others of verdant green. Luck whistled as he leaned forward to pat his mount's neck. It was so different from Midgarth, where forests and rocky scapes covered most of the land, and such soil as existed was hard to work. It is rich, your land, bountiful. Now it is, replied Toporak. But if you had sat your horse at this place but 30 years ago, you would have seen only ruin. Anazat told me a little of that when I first arrived, said Luck. Tell me more. The other man turned to him, into his eyes, that had been sparkling with the pleasure of the ride, came that sorrow Luck had noticed before, along with something else. It took him only a moment to recognize it, because he saw it sometimes when he gazed into the seeing waters at himself. It was shame. Toporak spoke again. That time I never think about. That time never leaves me, especially in sleep. You suffered. Yes, but that is not what haunts me. What does is the suffering I caused. He looked to the south, past Luck, who kept his own gaze on the man's eyes, for he could always read truths there. If you rode hard for 3 weeks, these two mountain ranges would sink into a vast plain, the sea of grass. You told me you were born there. I was. In my language, my people are called Taramazak. The nearest in your words would be... He looked above Luck for a moment. Those who hunt from the horse. What do you hunt? For centuries we hunted the... He paused. I do not know a word for this animal in your tongue. Maybe you...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.